Well, good morning. What a beautiful morning it is to be in worship with you. Welcome to First United Methodist Church, whose mission it is to be an irresistible catalyst of change for the love of Jesus Christ. I am Keith Fessel. I'm one of the pastors on the staff, and I am so pleased to be in worship with you this morning. Today, we continue our Crossing Borders sermon series, and I think Daniel's going to take us into the wilderness today, so we look forward to being amongst the nature today during our sermon time. For now, I invite you to stand as you are able. Find someone you do not know this morning and pass the peace of Jesus Christ.
Please remain standing and join me in our opening hymns.
Wasting.
I invite you to be seated as we all join together and go to God in prayer. Almighty God, we come together today to praise you, to sing joys of praise, prayers of longing connection, to bring your word, to be inspired. Dear God, teach us your wisdom. Open our minds to understand our place in this world. We ask today, dear God, that your love and wisdom flow through us, that we take it with us beyond these walls and into this world. And where we find hatred and mistrust, dear God, help us to sow seeds of peace. Remind us that all things we do and everywhere we go, we come back to you as our center. Lead our hearts to that path of truth. Help us to feel the Holy Spirit surround us, so that we may celebrate the ways that lead to life as we lift up all the prayers, the spoken and unspoken today, as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'd like to invite our children to go to children's worship at this time. Miss Brenda is over by the door. Parents, grandparents, if you have not signed your children in, I invite you to follow them out into the lobby, and Miss Brenda will take care of you out there. But for now, we get the wonderful gift of being given the Sound of Music by our chancel choir.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, choir. Today we are in the Gospel according to Mark, chapter 1, verses 9 through 15. We're going to be using the Message today. At this time, Jesus came from Nazareth in Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. The moment he came out of the water, he saw the sky split open and God's Spirit, looking like a dove, come down on him. Along with a spirit, a voice, "You are my son, chosen and marked by my love, pride of my life." At once the same spirit pushed Jesus out into the wild. For 40 wilderness days and nights he was tested by Satan. Wild animals were his companions and angels took care of him. After John was arrested, Jesus went to Galilee preaching the message of God. "Time's up. God's kingdom is here. Change your life and believe the message." My friends, this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. It is such a gift that you are here this morning. We are grateful for your presence. Welcome to the 8:30 service at First United Methodist Church. My name is Daniel Hilty, one of the pastors here. Grateful for you, grateful for the chance to share in worship with us this morning. So grateful for the beautiful anthem from our choir. As always, what a blessing. And as I was sitting up here singing the hymns, I was just thinking how good you sounded this morning, too. We sound good this morning. I'm not quite sure if we're inspired by the sunshine through the windows or the pollen in the air or whatever it is. Something is the spirit moving among us, and it's a blessing to have you here, especially if you're a guest. We hope somehow this hour you have a sense of just how much God loves you and Jesus loves you and we love you, and we want you to know you're always welcome here. So as we begin the sermon time, I'd like to ask you to please join with me in a moment of prayer. Let's pray. Oh God, your love is like an ocean. It sustains us and carries us through many storms. It is our water of life in a parched and desert and barren land. We pray, O Lord, that you would meet us once again this hour, or maybe for the very first time. We are thirsty for something, O God. Please come and quench our thirst in you. We entrust all that we offer up this hour into your hands, our music, our speaking, our hearing, our thinking, our feeling, our sharing, our giving, our receiving. Work through all of this, O Lord, to draw us closer to you, to Christ Jesus our Lord, and to our neighbors. We pray through your Holy Spirit. Amen. So today is the third installment in our Crossing Borders series. And every week in this series, you may remember if you've been here the last couple weeks, we are visiting a different location, slightly out of the way location around the world that is nonetheless important in Christian history, important to the story of us as followers of Jesus Christ. So far, for example, we took a look at a little island that converted an entire country. We visited a land of underground villages that figured out how to talk about Jesus in new ways. And today, the place we are visiting is the wilderness. Today, we're visiting the wilderness. Now, when people hear that word, wilderness, these days, I find they usually think of one of two things. Many people imagine something like this. This is the fun kind of wilderness, right? You go out there and you enjoy the great outdoors, right? You climb in the camper and you eat at picnic tables and you go for hikes and you have campfires and you sing kumbaya and you bathe in deep woods off, right? This is the kind of wilderness that is the stuff of, you know, mostly good memories, right? Except for the mosquitoes. Mostly good memories and the ticks. Other people, however, when they hear the word wilderness, will picture something more like this, right? This is the scary kind of wilderness, right? This kind of wilderness, it's almost more of a mental state than a physical place, isn't it? It's a place where you feel disoriented and lost and out of control, and there are wild things that you are afraid of. So if the fun kind of wilderness, the camper kind of wilderness, is the place where our good memories live, this kind of wilderness is where our fears live, right? And our regrets and our shame and our demons. So, quick show of hands, please. How many people would prefer to visit this kind of wilderness, the good memory campfire bug repellent kind of wilderness? Yeah, a lot of us. Good. And then secondly, how many people would prefer to visit this kind of wilderness, the home of our fears, our regrets, and our demons? A few. We have a few. Bless you. But not many, right? Not many. This is the kind of wilderness that not many people want to visit. Most of us prefer the fun camper kumbaya kind of wilderness. I mean, as a general rule, right, we should never agree to go camping at some place called the Shame and Regret National Park, right? It's not a good idea. Not many individuals ever choose intentionally to visit this kind of wilderness. Except, of course, for a few people, like this guy. Anybody know the name of this children's book? Where the Wild Things Are, right? Where the Wild Things Are. One of the most popular children's books ever by Maurice Sendak. Anybody familiar with this book, or who here is familiar with it? Yeah, a lot of. This is a great, great book. For those of you who don't know it, this book is all about a young little boy who intentionally chooses to visit the scary kind of wilderness, right? The land where his demons and monsters and wild things live. The boy's name is Max, by the way. That's him, the second from the left in the wolf pajamas and the crown, right? You see, as the story goes, one day after supper, does some harmful things, says some hurtful things, he's sent to his room. And there in his room, he takes an imaginary trip, a trip in his mind, to the land where the wild things are, also known as the wilderness, right? Also known as the wilderness. Where the wild things are is, by definition, the wilderness. It's in the name, right? So in his mind, Max goes to visit this scary place that most of us spend our lives trying to avoid, right? This place filled with monsters that symbolize his own anger and fear and frustration that night. And not only that, he even makes friends with the monsters, right? He even makes friends with the wild things. First, he tames them. Do you remember how he tames them? By staring in their yellow eyes, he says, right? He stares unblinkingly into their yellow eyes. He tames them. And then he makes them his friends. So much so, in fact, that they even hate to see him go at the end of the book, when the time finally comes for him to return to his room and finish his meal. They hate to see him go. "We love you so," they say. You know, I remember hearing this story as a child and being utterly fascinated. I thought it was amazing. I thought it was incredible that anybody would ever choose to visit this kind of wilderness, right? The big, scary kind of wilderness. I could barely get myself to visit the kumbaya fun kind of wilderness, right? Much less the big, scary, monster, wild thing kind of wilderness. And then on top of that, how amazing is it that a person would not only visit it, but actually make friends with the wild things that live there? Yet in the years since, I've learned that kind of experience, you know, it's not totally unheard of. In fact, Jesus himself did almost the same thing. in our scripture reading today. Now, in the Bible, of course, in the Bible, the wilderness, right, the wilderness looks a little different. The wilderness in the Bible looks less like a jungle and more like this, right? The wilderness in the Bible refers to much more of a desert land, probably not as barren as this picture, but close, right? Close. In the Bible, this is where the wild things are, right? This is where the demons live. And so in today's scripture reading, Jesus goes out into the wilderness, right? Kind of like this. And he faces the devil, he faces his demons, and he faces the wild things for 40 days and 40 nights. And interestingly enough, do you remember why Jesus went into the wilderness in the first place? I find this so interesting. Mark says, the Spirit pushed him into the wild, right? The Spirit pushed him into the wild. In other words, for Jesus, the wilderness was not some place that God wanted him to avoid, like most of the rest of us try to do. For Jesus to be Jesus, for Jesus to be the person that God wanted him to be, the wilderness was precisely where God wanted him to go. God wanted Jesus to go where the wild things are. And just like Max in that children's book, the wild things even became Jesus' friends. And I'm not just speaking metaphorically here. I don't know if you noticed it, but the Bible literally says that the wild things became Jesus' friends. It's in verse 13. In verse 13, we read, wild animals were his companions, right? And I find that so interesting. Jesus literally made friends with the wild things, right? Just like Max, where the wild things are, but set in Bible times. And so the story of Jesus in the wilderness is yet another example of someone like Max actually choosing to go into the wilderness and not trying to get out of it. Actually running toward the demons and not running away from them. It's the exact same choice that a follower of Jesus made yet again about 300 years later. This is Saint Anthony the Great. Anybody ever heard of Saint Anthony the Great? Saint Anthony the Great is a towering figure of the early church. I love his name, by the way. I think Saint Anthony the Great has a great name. Obviously, his parents had great expectations for him, right? You had set the bar high when you name your child the Great, right? Actually, historians call him the Great just to distinguish him from other Saint Anthonys. There are other Saint Anthonys, such as Saint Anthony the Mediocre, and Saint Anthony the You Could Do Better, right? And Saint Anthony the Meh, right? Now, Saint Anthony lived from the year 251 through 356. That's not a typo. He lived a long time, right? He lived a long time. He was preserved well out there in the desert. And from about the age of 18 years old onward, he dedicated himself to living out in the Egyptian desert, in the Egyptian wilderness, from 18 years old on, for a very long life. And just like Max and just like Jesus, Saint Anthony also spent his time in the desert dealing with demons and wild things and monsters of the metaphorical variety. For Anthony, his personal demons dealt a lot with his anger. They say that he dealt a lot with anger. Maybe it had something to do with the fact that he lived for 87 years in the desert. I don't know, but he dealt a lot with anger. But what's probably most noteworthy about Anthony is just how many other Christians followed in his footsteps. Karen Armstrong, who is a Christian historian, a brilliant church historian, estimates that just 50 years after Anthony died, just 50 years after Anthony died, tens of thousands of other Christian men and women had followed his example and gone into the wilderness to live there, to try to face their demons, to try to find God. Tens of thousands of other Christians choosing to live out where the wild things are, just 50 years after his death. Which brings us back to the question we've been wrestling with this whole sermon, which is, you know, why, right? Why? Why would anyone choose to do that? Why would even one person, much less thousands of people, tens of thousands of people, ever intentionally choose to live out in the wilderness? Why run toward your demons instead of away from them? Why intentionally choose to go where the wild things are? So to try to answer that question, I invite us to consider the 8th chapter of Mark. We're going to stay in Mark, but we're going to go to the 8th chapter, verses 34 through 35. In that passage, Jesus is speaking to his followers, but I think he's also talking about Anthony. Jesus said, "Don't run from suffering. Embrace it," he says. In other words, don't run from the wild things. Don't run from your demons. Run toward them. "Follow me," Jesus says, "and I'll show you the way, my way, to saving yourself, your true self." And that, I believe, is why Anthony and why tens of thousands of other Christian men and women went out into the wilderness where the wild things are. They did it because that is ultimately what the way of Jesus is all about. The way of Jesus is all about running toward suffering and not away from it, right? Running toward the hurt and not away from it. Out in the world and others and in ourselves. Because Jesus knew that the more we run away from the wild things in our lives, the more we run away from the difficult places in our lives, the shame, the discomfort, the guilt, the uncomfortable conversations, the more they will hurt us and haunt us and hunt us and control us. But when we finally stop running, when we finally stop running and turn and face them and stare them in the eyes, their yellow eyes, right, and offer them up to God in a spirit of graciousness and faith and love, that's when God can begin to transform them into something less frightening, right? Maybe even something that good things can come out of. Something unexpected. For example, some of you may know already, if you've been following the news, that this past week at the United Methodist General Conference, which is now over, delegates voted to create a special commission, maybe even call a special general conference in the near future, to get our denomination, to get us as a denomination, to actually start talking meaningfully and respectfully and civilly about the deep division in the United Methodist Church over issues of human sexuality and homosexuality, and to try to find a way together to move forward. Now, you know, some people think that didn't go far enough. Other people thought that went too far, but I think it's actually not bad, right? I see that choice, I see that decision as the United Methodist Church making the choice to finally stop running away from a difficult conversation, right? It's the choice to finally stop running away from an uncomfortable conversation and instead turning toward it and running toward it and embracing it and trying to work with God and with each other in that uncomfortable place, to try to actually find ways to move forward together for the purposes of Jesus Christ. Because as Christians, whenever we stop running away from the uncomfortable place, from the suffering, from the demons, from the wild things, and run toward it instead, that's an act of faith in Jesus Christ. That's an act of faith in this promise from Jesus Christ. And as an act of faith, God can use it to bless the world by showing the world that there is a different way, right? And a better way than just more and more fear and anger and division and rhetoric, right? And that promise is not just true for the church as a whole, it's also true for each of us individually. Because whenever we as Christians finally stop running away from the suffering in our lives, the demons, the wild things, the monsters, the difficult places, the guilt, the shame, the regret, Whenever we stop running away from the suffering and embrace it instead, that is also an act of faith that God can use, not just to bless us, but to bless ourselves, bless others, bless those around us. Some of you may remember, I once told a story many years ago about a man named Bill, not his real name, but a man named Bill, whose wife had taken her own life very early on in their marriage. And ever since then, Bill was haunted by this demon, right? He was haunted by this demon that kept chasing him. The regret, the shame, the guilt, the question, could I have done more, right? Should I have done more? And that demon, he said, was always chasing him, always at the back of his neck, always never letting him be. Until one day, Bill met a preacher named Tex, a Methodist preacher named Tex, and a woman named Karen. And he shared his story with them. And he talked about how this demon of guilt and shame and regret had been hunting him and haunting him and hurting him for years. And when he was done talking, Karen said the most remarkable thing. Karen said, "You know, Bill, I am a follower of Jesus Christ. And you may not know this, but as a follower of Jesus Christ, I am authorized to forgive sins. And so, whatever it is you think you may have done, whatever it is you think you may not have done, I want you to know that in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven, and you don't have to carry that burden alone anymore." And in that moment, by the power of God, it was as if Bill at long last turned and stared the demon in the eyes, right? The wild thing in the eyes. And suddenly, it didn't quite have so much power over him anymore. It was as if he stopped running away from the wilderness and did this, embraced it instead. And ironically, it was not until that moment when he stopped finally running away from his demons that he could at long last start to feel free of them. My friends, whatever the demon is in your life right now, whatever the demon is that you are running away from or hoping to avoid, whatever that wild thing is that keeps you up and makes you afraid in the middle of the night, whatever the suffering, God's invitation this day is to turn and face it and look it in its eyes. Right? You don't have to give it authority over your life anymore. And you don't have to allow it the power to define you anymore. And you don't have to beat yourself up for it forever. Why? Because in the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Can you say that with me, please? In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Thank you. Turn to a neighbor and say that, please. Thank you. And in the name of Jesus Christ, God makes you strong. And in the name of Jesus Christ, God makes you free. And in the name of Jesus Christ, who chose to run toward the cross, right? Not away from it, who chose to run toward the cross. In the name of that Jesus Christ, if we turn and face the wild things in our lives and don't run away from them forever, God can transform that act, that turning, into our moment of resurrection. That can be the moment that our real life begins. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Whenever I think of wilderness, I think of Jesus praying, always going into prayer as he went into the wilderness. And today, our faith works, our opportunity to live out our discipleship plan, our opportunity to grow closer to Jesus Christ, is lifting up opportunities for prayer. On your blue Catalyst card, I encourage you to pick one of these things. You could pray at home. You could keep a prayer journal. Perhaps join a prayer team. We would get back to you if you put that. Prayer walks, thankfulness journals. There are many opportunities, many different ways in which we can live out our prayer life. And I encourage you to think about that and pick one of those and perhaps write that on your Catalyst card and offer it up to God in our offering. Before we ask our ushers to come forward, I do want to lift up the inside of our bulletin today, our celebrating ministries. Two things. This week we celebrated with Kristen as she was nominated for the Zonta Woman of Achievement. And a lot of the resources that you give her enable her to live out those gifts that she has, and we want to thank you for helping there as well. We also gave out, I had the privilege of giving out a Thorpe Gordon Award for an outstanding student this week, and again, it's our partnership, it's the giving that you do, it's the volunteering that you do, it's all the ways in which you help us live out ministry, and that's why these times of offering and all that you do to give and volunteer of your time is so key to spreading the word of Jesus Christ in this community. So I want to thank you for that as we move forward in our time of offering.
Please stand.
Let us thank God and lift up all that we offer to God by joining together in the unison prayer found on the screens. Lord of heaven and earth, we long to connect with you. Help us to grasp the freedom that comes from seeing you more clearly, loving you more dearly, and following you more nearly. Help us to deepen our ability to pray day by day to be your people in this time, in this community. Amen. I invite you to remain standing for our closing hymn, Trust and Obey, number 467.
Thank you.
Few announcements before we go today. It's time to sign up for Mad Camp and Vacation Bible School. Please call the church office if you're interested in doing that. Those are coming up before we know it, and we just can't wait to celebrate and have all the young kids roaming around the building and celebrating Jesus Christ. It's one of my favorite times of the year. A reminder that photo directories are here. If you had your picture taken, you are in it, so please stop by and get a photo directory at the welcome desk and then sign your name to the sheet of paper there so that we make sure that you got your photo directory. Just a reminder there. Also, let you know that we are celebrating Reverend Jeannie Martin Dudenhofer's ministry with us as she has been reappointed. May 28th, that's a Saturday, from 2 to 5 here at the church, we'll be celebrating her ministry. So please, if you can either send a card or look forward to coming at that time, that would be a wonderful thing to do. Next week is our last week of Crossing Borders series, and I invite you to come back. We will be delving into another mystery, and it's a bit about Doubting Thomas. Whatever happened to Doubting Thomas? Some of us may know the story of what happened to him to make him call Doubting Thomas, but what happened after that? And whatever happened to him, when he said, prove to me, Jesus, that you are who you say you are. Look 3,000 miles east of where that happened to get a hint of where he may have went and what happened to him. But come back next week for all those details. But for now, through the grace and peace of Jesus Christ, may we have the wisdom to be transformed and change our community. Go in peace. Amen.